Hey now, people, this is Calvin here with the Boneyard TV Show, and you're listening to Outdoor Adventures with Jayson.
Welcome to Outdoor Adventures with Jayson. Each week, I bring the world of hunting, fishing, and conservation to you. From the great hunting and fishing opportunities found in the Americas to the dream safaris located on the dark continent beyond, I'll introduce you to those who are already out in the field living every outdoor enthusiast's dream, as well as outfitters and gear manufacturers that can make those dreams your reality. Welcome to this week's episode of Outdoor Adventures with Jayson. I am really excited today. I've got a guy that I've been talking with for, about a year or so, and he brings just some amazing outdoor content, and his name is Jayson Acorn. And for many of you in the States, you might not recognize that name, but if you head out to his website, theboneyardtv.com, you're going to just see some amazing hunting videos, photos, and the whole nine yards, and a neat product we're going to touch on that he has. So Jayson, how are you doing today?
Really good, Jayson. Thanks for having me. I'm pretty excited to be back here on your podcast and having a chat with you.
Yeah, that first episode was a complete total goof on my part, so I appreciate getting you back on because I think your message is so spot on for everything that stands for hunting nowadays, with the anti-hunters on one side, hunters on the other side, and all those people in the middle that are confused by all the noise. And so I love what your show does, promotes, and how it presents itself. For the folks that are in the United States that may not have seen your show, give me a little history on the Boneyard TV, if you would.
Well, let me tell you, Jay, Kelvin and I, when we first started talking about maybe eventually having a TV show up here in Alberta, it was all about having fun and getting out there and doing what we love to do, the passion of the outdoors and yada, yada, right? Everybody that hunts loves to get out there and be able to brag about their adventures. And the cool thing about what Kelvin and I did with the Boneyard is we decided, okay, next year, let's get on TV. And it actually took us a year and a half, and we were up on Wild TV and really sort of learning as we went. So it was pretty raw. It was pretty rough around the edges, but that's sort of how we wanted to make a stand in hunting TV and in the industry. You know, we decided that, you know, you could watch one show and you could watch 10 shows, and they were all sort of the same format. They had the same sort of redundant music and all of that. And we wanted to just go right out of left field, sort of express who we are as people, as hunters, as family men. And the bottom line was, we don't take ourselves too seriously, but we take our passion of hunting very seriously. So our show is, you know, it's got some heavy metal. It's got some wisecracks. We sort of beat up each other. If you screw up, if a cameraman misses a shot or something, then, you know, he gets bloodied a little bit and bashed. But it's all in good fun. It's the camaraderie that we have amongst our group of guys that we're confident. And that's what it is. We are confident in expressing our way of life. And if it means having a girl come out totally drop dead sexy and shooting a bow and making fun of one of our pro staffers, then we're going to do that because it's a little bit of clickbait. It's a little bit of fun and it's entertainment. And a lot of people forget that watching the hunting industry, you know, that you need to be entertained. We want you sitting in front of the TV from the opening credits all the way to the ending credits. And a lot of these shows, you can turn it on. You can decide, okay, they're hunting whitetail. Okay, I'll come back in 22 minutes and see the kill shot. And that's the formula of a lot of the hunting TV shows. So we wanted to come in, maybe give you two or three kill shots, give you a tip of the week, throw in some clickbait, have a couple laughs, some beautiful Canadian, Alberta, Saskatchewan, BC scenery, show you how we hunt, which is fair chase, which is do-it-yourself hunting, which is, if it's not up in the foothills of the Canadian Rockies, it's down in the Badlands and the river bottoms and the coulees looking for muleys, or hunting prairie elk or bighorn sheep up in the mountains. Like, we do it all, and we're very happy to show everybody the wonderful footage that we have.
Because you're not on down here in the States, I actually stumbled across you a year or so ago through Facebook, and I'll have the link for your TV show and you on the show notes of this. I started catching some of the videos that you and Calvin were posting, and that's exactly exactly what you said. And I didn't find out till later that there was some of the beautiful women in there. That's just icing on the cake. What was really cool was it was hunting. It wasn't scripted. It wasn't the formulatic or formula show that said, here, I'm going to go out there. And like you said, 22 minutes later, here's my kill. And there's just a bunch of, fluff in the middle.
Yeah.
It was straight hardcore hunting.
You know what, Jayson? To put on a truly entertaining hunting show, you got to realize that this isn't reality TV. What it is it's documentary. So it is okay to go back after your hunt and fill in all the B-roll, the walking, some more scenic shots. But the hunting itself needs to be captured in the raw form. You cannot do those crazy shots where, you're coming over a hill and you crest over and the camera's on the other side catching your face as you come over because it's so unrealistic. One of the shots that I just cannot stand is when a hunter's in the blind, they show the hunter, then they show the deer, and then they show the hunter again with the camera outside the blind shooting in. And you're like, okay, well, I thought there was a deer out there, but obviously the cameraman is standing in between the hunter and the deer, and it just really, it takes you away from the moment, and it's got to be real. And that's where we decided, if I really screw up and I miss that shot, I'm not lying. That happens, and I missed that deer, and I'm going to show it, and then my partner is going to jump in and rip me a new one, and I'm going to comment, and then we'll move on, and then maybe get them in the next segment.
Yeah, that type of setup, and the one that absolutely just kills it, and it was the big thing through the 80s, and all, is when they show the hunter or the guide and the hunter walking up to the animal and the camera shots on the other side of the animal, like this is the first time they've seen it.
Especially
in a winter scene when you look and you can see the snow is beat down all around the animal.
Yeah, those are some things that you can't hide. If you're a very aware viewer, you're going to pick up on that. And if you're a hunter, and that's why the big consensus is that, the big time mountain hunters and hunters, they just can't stand watching hunting shows because it's little things like that that really turn you off. Now, what I would do is if I killed the animal, what you do is typically if I'm in a tree stand, I have my main camera that's on the animal. Then I have a smaller type of a GoPro or an ion camera that's shooting back at me. It's on my bow or rifle. And so it's showing me, then I can show the animal. But then even better is if you have a third camera that can capture both you and the animal in the same frame. So then you have that relationship of, he is really close to that deer. You can really see the interaction between the prey and the predator. And then when you shoot it, you catch it running off, you turn it back to the hunter. You want to capture the real effects of him shaking, the buck fever, the whatever, his enjoyment. But then once you go in, I don't ever go scout and find the deer before the camera finds. I grab the camera and then it's with me as I'm tracking. And then it is a real moment. And then the expressions are real. Everything is real. And that is very important. You can always go back and redo some shots and try to reenact those feelings, and that's fine, but you got to be good at it.
Right.
And that is the thing. You cannot fake certain things. It just does not work. It comes out flat. It comes out contrived and fake. And that really hurts you in the long run.
And that's one of the things I thought was really neat about that content that you're putting out is that it's hunting. It's what you get when you four or five buddies go out, two buddies go out. And as you said, one of them makes a screw up or one of them makes a great shot. Either way, they're getting feedback from their hunting partner, good or bad.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's what friends are for, right?
And then you, as the person that got the feedback, you or Kelvin, whoever, is waiting, because if that person messes up, you're waiting to pounce.
Absolutely.
And that's kind of, I think guys can relate, women can relate, that's just kind of a feeling that everybody can relate to. And so it's amazing some of the shows that you put out, the episodes I've watched. And there's a short video, and this thing's been floating around for a while now on Facebook, and I see people keep sharing it on occasion, and I don't know if it's you or Kelvin, but or one of your pro staff, but somebody drills a moose.
Yes, that's missile payment.
Tell me, what did he shoot it with?
Well, he was actually he shot that moose in the Edmonton bow zone. So it's just a bow zone. There's no rifle hunting. And a lot of these fields and sections of land are actually within the city limits. So it's the Edmonton bow zone. And Mitchell is actually hunting a white-tailed deer that he calls Lucky. And he's about 190 inches. The night before, he's sitting in his stand and this bull moose comes out into the alfalfa field. So fast forward to the next day, he's sitting up in his stand and what comes out right below him is this bull moose. Wide open for elk, whitetail, mule deer, moose, anything that walks into your stand. If you have a tag, you can pretty much take it with a bow. So this moose comes out and Mitchell, he's shooting our very own killing sticks, our own company, and totally put just a great shot on this moose. And it is just the most unreal kill shot and a quick kill. The moose dies like within 20 seconds, blood flying. Like it's just a gore fest, but it is just so amazing to watch. If you are a hunter, you get it. You know, everything was done so good. And this clip has been, geez, on YouTube alone on the first run, it was over 330,000 views. And like you said, it's just been shared over and over and over. I've caught people passing it off as their own kill. It's just been wonderful. And it's been banned a few times, but then we get it back on and it's shared again. And it's still making a run. And I think you're going to see that clip for years to come.
And I think if you're probably an anti-hunter or not a hunter, but not against it, you look at this clip and you'll go, God, that's brutal. But if you're a hunter, you look at it and go, man, that arrow did exactly what it needed to do. And that moose was dead on his feet. He just didn't know it yet.
Absolutely, man. But he was so full of blood.
Yeah, it's incredible. And that kind of leads me to where I'm going, because as we've talked over the last year, and even a year ago, when we first did our first interview that didn't go right, you were just setting up to head to the ATA show with your new arrows.
That's right, Jayson. Thanks for reminding me. And I've got a lot of info to catch you up on. Yeah.
I'm not a vertical bow hunter. So for the listeners that are, you were headed down to the ATA show and the arrows were not new, but they were newer. You had bringing them along. And now fast forward, what, eight months or so. And I've heard nothing but good things and seen nothing but good things about these arrows. And they're called the killing sticks. And tell the listeners all about this concept, this process, and what you got, because I think vertical bow hunters are going to love this.
Oh man, Jay, it has been such a wonderful 5 or 6 months. When we went down to Indianapolis for the ATA show, it was pretty much the debut of our arrow company south of the border. And after a bunch of legwork, phoning companies, phoning distributors before we went down, within the first 5 minutes, Nate Hendricks from Kinsey's came by. And he was the very first guy that walked up to us. And we ended up, we are now in Kinsey's catalog, which will be distributed throughout the United States. I think it's more of a central, south central or Midwest. It turned out so good. And to explain a little bit about our arrow line, we have it is called the Killing Sticks, which really just, it's just the perfect name for who we are as a company and as hunters. And it screams volumes on how we perceive hunting. You know, they're arrows, but they are killing sticks. They kill, and it's not a joke. And they were made to kill whatever you aim at. In our lineup, we have multiple arrows. We've got five different lines right now. It starts off at the Hawkeyes. They are a .006 straightness, our entry level arrow, extremely great arrow. And I need to point out that the straightness rating on our arrows is the full 32 inches of the arrow. So if you're shooting a .006, you cut off 4 or 5 inches, you are probably now shooting a .003. Because those arrows are that good. Premium carbon technology, the latest technology, the finest carbon. When we were down, I just want to get away from the arrow lineup. When we were at the ATA show, we had multiple meetings with Victory Arrows. They just loved everything about what we were doing, the name, the logo, the quality of the carbon weaves, and they really want to team up with us. So it was a really good shot in the arm for for us and a pat on the back, because we knew what we had was a great product, and to have Victory come around and just not leave us alone and almost harass us to partner up with them really, really spoke volumes for us. So getting back to the arrows, you can move back up to the Hawkeye is a 0.245 ID, so pretty much a regular size arrow. You can go up to the original. Again, it's 0.245 ID, 0.003 straightness. Great overall hunting arrow, just target arrow. It's a real good base arrow. It is our original. Then when you get up to our ventilator, now you're getting a smaller diameter, 0.204. It's a lighter arrow. It's smaller arrow. It is a deadly arrow. Good for target shooting. I have pro shooters that have actually dropped the fat shafts and are shooting my ventilators because of how quickly they tune, and they keep the tune and they just shoot them just flawlessly. So it's been a great arrow. I have used that arrow for many seasons in the field, and I mean, they're just so fantastic. If you want to get extreme, we have a micro ventilator, which is a 0.165. It's tiny. It is our most heaviest arrow. It is a beast. I have taken a mule deer at 93 yards, passed through, just destroyed the deer, and it was by far the best shot of my life. But those arrows, they allow you to do shots like that over and over and over. They are just so good. 0.001 straightness, and again, 32 inches. So it's like it's flawless. Once you cut it, it is absolutely flawless. It's hard to find the spine on it. It is so good.
Okay, so
and then our last arrow.
Let me just take a step back. Repeat that again. Did you just say you took a mule deer at 93 yards with a bow?
I did. Season 5 coming up this year, and I did it solo on camera. Just the greatest stalk in the middle of an alfalfa field. No, nothing behind me. It was one of those hunts where I just had to sort of sit down and reflect on my hunting life and where the things I've done to that moment. I decided, like, this is where I've wanted to be as a hunter, to be able to do something like this and sneak up on 3 big bucks and take a beautiful deer at 93 yards in the open. And it was one of those, I can't wait for the episode to come out. I am just jonesing for this episode.
Well, and the reason I mention that is when I say hunters, men or women, they can't take a mule deer at 93 yards with a rifle. And so take one out with a bow. I've seen some of this long distance shooting is becoming more and more popular, and I don't agree or disagree with it, because if the hunter is capable and the job is done, power to them. So
absolutely, Jay. You know, like there are pro shooters that do the circuit. They do the paper, they do the 3D targets, and they X every target, and they're unbelievable shots. They can guess the range, the yardages without a range finder. But then you get them out in the field, and it's a little different when it's a live animal, and you get shaky, you hold your breath, and then, you know what? It's a different thing. What I do, and any pro shooter that is like me, you shoot 70, you shoot 80, you shoot 90, and that's what you shoot. You don't shoot 20 or 30. Like, why would you? Because you know that when you're shooting 70, 80, 90 yards, you're going to be like dead nuts at 60. And I'm not saying I would like to have to shoot that far every time, because even though I have taken quite a few animals at over 60 and 70 yards, I like the up close and personal. So the closer the better, always. It's always best. And I felt at that moment when the sun came up and I got into position, I felt confident. I was steady. I was like a rock. I was focused. Sweet. And I put the smack down on him. It was perfect.
And as a hunter, and that's, I think it's awesome one way or another, if the person chooses to do it or not do it, I don't care, as long as they're confident and competent.
Qualified, absolutely.
So power to you. I think that's awesome. But when you said 93 yards, I was just like, excuse me?
I'm talking like the biggest mule kick. Like his toe was touching the ground when his back cheek kicked up. Like it was just the greatest footage.
And that was with a micro ventilator?
Just wait, it was. Absolutely. So the micro ventilator that I shot, I had an 89 grain outsert on the tip, which gives you that extra front loading heavy tip, which just gives you that kinetic force when you hit the animal, and it just blew right through it. So if you measured the whole arrow with that 89 grain outsert, and I'm at about 10.2 grains per inch on the arrow, and then 100 grain tip, I was well over 500 grains. So it was a pretty heavy loaded arrow, and that's why they're so good at the long range, because the small diameter with the heat, the boning heat veins, which are a little lower profile, little longer, but lower profile, it cuts right through the air. The wind doesn't deflect it as much. And then when it hits, it's got that weight. It just keeps going. Wow. It's hard to stop it. So it was, I never did find the arrow. I looked and looked and looked and looked, but found that deer not very far away.
So if the person goes out to Killin Stix, and that's spelled KILLNSTIX.com, KillinStix.com.
You got betcha.
Five arrows. So if you cover the gamut, if that person's shooting a regular bow, they want just a traditional arrow, they can get it. If they want the tournament arrow, they can get it. All of that stuff.
That's right. Absolutely. Our tournament arrow is our 23 series fat shaft arrow for indoor and multiple outdoor paper shooting. We have a number of pro shooters across Canada that are on top of the podium every tournament shooting our tournament series arrows. They're a .001 arrow, again, 32 full inches. It is absolutely the most flawless arrow you're going to find, and it's super light. I think a 400 spine tournament is roughly about 6.1 grains, so you don't want to get much lower than that, but just a great arrow. Kelvin and I are just so tickled and just so excited, because I can talk all day about these arrows because they're that good. There's nothing about them that makes us cringe or worried. It's just so flawless. We're actually in the works right now to get a local component maker here in Alberta. We're slowly bringing, we're sourcing what we can locally. If we can't get it here, we look down south in the States and just get like our boxes and stuff like that. They originated in China. Now we're getting them here in Canada, which is just so great for us, because that's just one thing we want to do.
Oh yeah,
but
keep it local.
We have,
you know, and then distribute worldwide if at all possible.
Yeah, absolutely. But we sell online. Our arrow line is actually starting to make a breakthrough in Utah. I met a guy up here at a trade show in Edmonton who is now a good friend of mine. His name is Robbie Badger. His family owns Jumping Jack Trailers in Salt Lake City, Utah. Robbie, he's right across the aisle from our booth, and we have this 40-inch TV just showing highlight clips of that moose kill, of my mule deer kill, just over and over on loop, and his eyes are just getting bigger and bigger. So Robbie ended up buying some microventilators. He goes back to Utah. He hands them over to his bow tech. And I kept phoning him, "Have you shot them yet, Rob? Have you shot them?" Because no. But my bow tech phoned me today, and he says, "Where did you get those arrows, man?" He goes, "They're from Canada." And he goes, "Wow, they're legit. They are legit." So now they're starting to spread a little bit down in Utah. And that's the greatest thing. You know, you get a good hunter who's really personable and has a lot of friends, and if he likes them, you know, his buddies are going
to
buy them.
Yeah, that won't take long for that to spread in the States. Well, I'm not a vertical bow hunter. I've read nothing but positive reviews about these things online. And with you and Kelvin and the rest of your team backing it up, you know, if one of the listeners wants to talk arrows and figure out what the right arrow is, there's a contact button on the Killin Stix website. And one of you guys, I'm sure, will step right up and school them on what's going to work, you know, or what they should try.
Absolutely. You know what, Jason, I'd like to mention one thing is that we have right now a pro hunter, a hunter pro staff program going on right now.
Sure.
So if anybody out there in radio land would like to try out our arrows, all we suggest you do is email your hunting resume to info@killinstix.com, and then we will make a file for you and give you a heck of a good deal on your first dozen arrows. And then the more you promote us, we will keep track. And then maybe next year you'll get half off or free arrows.
See.
And it just grows. It just depends on the person and promoting, sending pictures and spreading the word.
That's a heck of a deal. And I'm sure there's folks that will be listening to this and contacting you. And I'll have that in the show notes so that if you're driving or whichever, you just refer to the show notes and you'll be able to easily touch base with Jayson and Kelvin and start talking to them about what's available to you on the the pro staff line, because the more you promote these guys, the better it is for you. Everybody knows arrows can be expensive. And so if you're helping them grow, they're going to help you.
Absolutely.
Well, with that, right on. Where this all started was the Boneyard TV. And
yeah,
you've been on Wild TV now for 2 or 3 seasons. And for those in the States, Wild TV is the Canadian equivalent of like the Sportsman's Channel or the Outdoor Channel. But it broadcasts just north of our border and shows Canadian hunting shows.
Yep, you got that right. We were actually on Wild TV for 4 years.
Oh, four.
And walked away from Wild TV with over 30,000 followers, which really, I think we were the fastest growing outdoor hunting channel in Canada ever. We've really just really did everything we could with Wild TV. So we're taking our next step. And now what we're doing is it's like the hunting industry on the TV side has evolved, and it's slowly making its way just online, which is very beneficial for guys like us, because now what we do is we save that money. There's a misconception that on the Outdoor Channel and the Pursuit that everybody gets paid to have their show on there. Well, that may be true on some of the big branded heavy hitters. They may get paid, but 90% of the shows do not. They pay. And as the years go by, the amount of dollars go up. So now, Calvin and I are just so happy that we will be saving all of that money and using it to promote our new channel, which should be up next month. And it is called Twisted Outdoors TV. And it is an online free subscription channel for everybody out there. We want to bring them along with us and give them an even greater entertainment bang for the buck. All our episodes will be condensed, re-edited from season 1 all the way up to our new season 5, which will start uploading next month, 1 a week. And I do believe it'll be like a Netflix layout where you can go on, choose any episode. I think when we get season 6 up, we will have close to 70 episodes up.
Wow.
So there's a lot of content there, a lot of old stuff that makes me cringe, but will probably make you laugh, and some awesome hunts right from season 1 all the way to our new season. It's really great for me to go back and look at season 1 and go, ooh, boy, I look good, but I sound like shit. And, you know, it's just, I'm a rookie. I didn't know what I was doing. But to see how we've evolved and just, man, we work so hard at trying to put out a real, real good product for the viewers. And that's what this is all about. You know, we want to have fun and we want you to have fun.
Well, and the listeners on the show can also head over to your website, theboneyardtv.com. And there's a subscription section on there. And that's what I belong to. You go in there and it's behind a firewall, so to speak. And oh gosh, there's got to be 50, 60 videos on there at least.
Yep, there's a ton of clips. Lots of good content, and there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff. I mean, that's the thing too with Twisted Outdoors. We can put stuff on there that we weren't allowed to put on there with Wild TV. So you never, I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag, but there's some stuff in there that'll, your eyeballs will pop right out of your head.
Well, there's an episode on and I'm not going to give the whole rundown of it, but there's a car, a woman, and an explosion. Put them in whatever order you want to put them in your mind, but head on over and subscribe to the Boneyard TV so you can watch it. Cause it's pretty funny. Some of the stuff you guys do just cracks me up. And that's what I love about watching you guys, is just that we're doing the job. We're hunting correctly. We're showing hunting as it is for many people that do it in that lifestyle, but we're not, as you said, putting out a documentary.
Yeah, man. Like you do not want to get up and grab a beer. You want to sit down because you do not know what you're going to miss. And that's the great thing about the Boneyard, is that it's click, 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 click. Your eyes are always bouncing back and forth. We do our homework. Yeah, this is like a business for us. So we try hard in every way possible to keep you fixed on the TV screen. We don't want you to leave. We want you to watch every single second because it's all good. That's the thing, you know, if we're not hunting at the moment and we're doing a talk or a tip, it all still has to be entertaining. And it starts with the host and it starts with the footage and the camera work. It all has to work together. And we understand that, and we realize the things that we need to do to keep you entertained.
We've got the Killin' Stix arrows, which is your main product there and has done fantastic. And you'll be at the ATA show again for 2017.
You know what? It's still up in the air. It was a great show. We'd love to do it, but we might switch it up. We might do the Kinsey's trade show, or it's just sort of up in the air right now. I do know that we will be really looking forward to heading out to Eastern Canada, maybe Ontario or Quebec, and do a couple trade shows there, maybe an archery tournament or two, and bring our whole lineup of arrows and catalogs and all that great stuff. When it comes down to the States, that is where the market is. That is it. That is Shangri-La for us. So, of course, we want to be down there this or next year. We just have not decided where we're going to be yet.
You and Kelvin are the main guys on this show. There's no, you're strictly the TV show and the arrows. You don't book any hunts or anything of that nature with people, do you?
No, we don't. But I do hunt or host every once in a blue moon when I feel like there's somebody that I would love to hunt with, or that I would love, that would be great on the Boneyard. I give them a call and I bring them up. So for a non-resident alien, so somebody from the States, I can only hunt or host every 2 years. But for anybody across Canada wide, I can hunter host every year. So okay. I don't really, we're not outfitters. No, we're not. We are just hunters.
Folks, so that's the thing, is get out there, support, head over to Boneyard TV, check it out. They've got good sponsors there listed. Check those out because they're putting out a good product. You can go to Killin' Stix for the arrows, and then the TV is going to be Twisted
Outdoors. We will be keeping everybody updated on either the Killin' Stix page or the Boneyards page or my personal page, Jayson Acorn. As soon as we have any more new info, we will let the masses know so they can keep track and jump over as soon as it's up.
Sweet. So they'll be able to binge watch on the tablet, on the desktop, wherever they got an internet connection, they can watch the
Absolutely.
Boneyard TV. That's
awesome. And Roku.
Oh, yeah. And you're going to distribute on Roku as well.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, see, now that makes it great and totally opens up your market.
It really does. And what we're working on now too is it's a tough nut, but I'm seeing the meat eater, Steve Ranilla, and someone else, but they're on Netflix now. So I'm checking out Crave, Hulu, Netflix. It's not easy, but it's like anything. You got to put your head down, ass up, and get at it and keep going until you get her done.
And I would encourage anybody that's listening, if you have a Netflix account, you can go into the search or options or settings. I can't remember exactly what it is on, but it, just do a little hunt and peck, and it's not that big of a site to find it. Mm-hmm. And you can tell them that you know, like those hunting shows, watch those hunting shows, go in and request more hunting shows content, put in there you want the Boneyard TV, let the folks at Netflix know this is what you want to see. You're paying, and they've got a lot of great stuff. They're starting to pick up some hunting and fishing stuff. Let's get some more on there, because, you know, face it, it's dollars. They can get a lot of content from somebody like you guys a lot cheaper than they can by going out and making their own show.
So, absolutely, and that is the great thing about these specific channels, is that they do pay for content, unlike the Pursuit and Wild TV and those types. So it's very lucrative, and it could be a very, very good thing for a guy like myself.
Sure.
Well, and that's who works their butt off for nothing.
Exactly. And that's the deal, is without having to pay that Wild TV, you're going to increase your distributorship from, not that there's anything wrong with being broadcast in Canada. That's your home country, and that's great. But mm-hmm. you know that the market has to be south of the border for you as well.
And absolutely.
So now you got the States, where you go up to somebody and say, what's the Boneyard TV? I don't know. A year from now, oh man, look at this. This is great. I've seen these guys on YouTube. I've seen them on Facebook. And it only helps to continue to promote and compensate. And when I say compensate, it's money and respect mm-hmm. for the work that you and Kelvin are doing.
Totally true. The one thing that really sort of finalized our thoughts of where we need to be with our show and our production company was when we were down at Indianapolis at the ATA show, and we had multiple people from Tennessee, from Kentucky, come up to us and say, hey, we saw that moose clip. We shared it. It was unbelievable. And like, Kelvin and I were just blown away. It's like, well, that's social media for you. That's online. The reach is just it's endless, and it'll go as far as you want it to go as long as you're working hard at it. But when you're on one channel, on a station, you need those subscribers to watch. And if you don't have the subscribers, then, you know, it's sort of, you're wasting your time. Yeah. It's the best move for us. We are taking a step forward, and we're climbing that ladder. You know, we've got some goals we still haven't reached, and we're getting close.
So tell me, any big hunts coming up for you? I know hunting season's kind of just ending, you know, or has ended, but what's in the pipelines for, what are you planning to do next?
Well, Jason, I'll tell you, the grass is finally coming out. The dandelions are starting to pop out. So the big black bear are running around. So the bears are starting to be hunted. I don't do baiting, but what I do is spot and stalk, and it is so much fun. So, Calvin and I will be leaving here in about a week and a half for a northern black bear spot and stalk hunt, which is just so exciting. But later on this fall, the big hunt that I am doing is a BC goat hunt. And I'm telling you, sweet. I cannot wait. The zone I am hunting goat in has been closed for 13 years. They just opened it up this year. My cousin, Brett Acorn, lives in BC. He's got a couple real big outfitters and sheep hunters that are going to be tagging along. So I've got such a good crew. I'm so excited. So that's going to be on the top of the list. But other than that, it is big Alberta coulee, badland mule deer. We got oat-eaten alfalfa slamming whitetail that I've got a couple that eluded me last year, but I'm a little smarter this year. And I'm hoping to get a really nice whitetail down. But one of the hunts that I'm really excited for is the Sutfield elk herd. They have been hammered so hard on the Sutfield Air Force Base that they've driven them off the base, and now all the farmers are having lots of problems. But these big elk are up to like 400 inches. Wow. And they are bone white antlers because there's no trees. They live in little draws, little swamp lowlands in fields, and it is such a unique hunt. And I've been down there scouting, getting land, lots of permission, looking for sheds. So that is one hunt that I am extremely stoked for this year.
And isn't Alberta, it seems to me, if you head up quite a ways north in Alberta, it's where you can get those big wood bison.
Yeah, wood buffalo. There's a herd up there, and this is a really unique hunting territory, because anybody from the States can just come up and hunt this herd. You don't need a tag. You don't need a hunter host. You don't need anything. This herd, there's two huge herds up in northern Alberta. There's the Zama Lake herd, and then you got the wood buffalo herd. Well, the wood buffalo herd has tuberculosis. And I'm not saying every buffalo has it, but it is in the herd. So what they want to do is trim down the wood buffalo herd to keep them from moving west and getting into contact with the Zama herd and infecting them.
Okay.
So there are some huge, huge bulls, big bison up there. It is really a tough, tough hunt. Swampy, just, oh man, it is, it's hell on earth up there, but you could walk out of there with 1,500 pounds of buffalo.
See, that's amazing. And you're going to be getting a call from me one of these days. I was at the Dallas Safari Club show, and I spoke with an outfitter, and I have their name put away, so I can't give it to you because I just don't have it off the top of my head. But I spoke with an outfitter that was about 3 hours north of Edmonton.
Right.
West and north. For those of us coming up from south of the border, we can take two bears up there in the fall. I think you can take two in the spring, too. But it's a two-bear hunt. Now, it is baited, but I've got the mobility challenges, so I kind of have to compensate a little bit for that. And
it's so good for you, man.
You're going to get a call. I'm going to be flying into Red Deer and hijacking you and Calvin if possible, and we're gonna go up there and hunt some black bear, because they were showing me pictures of the bears. And I grew up over by Ontario, hunted Ontario, fished Ontario.
Yep.
You take a 200-pound bear, that's good. A 300-pound bear is a monster. In Alberta, a 300-pound bear is a 2-year-old bear that you pass.
There's some giant bear here. Well, they gotta compete with the grizzly bears, right? So they gotta be bigger. They get killed.
They're showing me these, I think, 8-foot, 7-foot caped out bears, and I'm going, holy smokes!
Yep.
And you know, and it's my idea of roughing it, a lodge, cooked food, TV, DVDs.
Life is good.
Life, you know, and a beer. I can get a good Labatt's or a good Molson that's not watered down when they cross the border with them. So, you know.
Nothing but high test up here, Jay. You know that. You're Canadian.
So that's a call you're going to get as soon as I figure out a time that I can get up there to do that. Because these people were showing me and I'm just going, those aren't bears. Those are, you know, those are baby moose, small bison that they're shooting.
They're big. They are big.
The color phase was fairly, not common, but not bad, not hard to get either. So just Alberta to me, if I ever had to leave the States as far as hunting, you get up to Alberta and you've got elk and mule deer and the bison, and I mean, it just, the list goes on, and it's an absolute
land of the giants. It is, you know, it's like North America's Africa is in Alberta. You got the mountains with the goats and the bighorn, and man, you can hunt almost anything here other than caribou and grizzly. And you know, we just down south there, I had never seen so many speed goats in my life. They're really bouncing back. We've had so many good winters now. I think we've had 4 good winters in a row, and the animals are really bouncing back, and is healthy numbers, big deer, big elk, big moose, you name it. It's just, I am so fortunate to be able to live here and have grown up a hunter here in Alberta.
Yeah, great area. Well, I'll tell you what.
It is.
I want to be respectful of your time, Jayson. And
all right.
I appreciate everything you've done and what you've shared with the listeners. And for the listeners, these are the guys you want to support. Get out there, help them. And even if it's not subscribing to their channel, you know, on the paid side, go to like their Facebook page, promote their arrows, check them out, email them with questions. Just in a little bit that Jayson talked about arrows, do you think he's not going to help you out and answer any of your technical questions? You're going to get more information than you probably even know how to process.
We could go on and on and on.
Exactly. If you're a diehard hunter and you have a good resume, let him know. Let him see what you're doing. Him and Kelvin will look at that and possibly be able to put you up on a pro staff position to help not only promote you, but to promote them. Get involved. Contact these guys. They're easy to find on Facebook. I'm going to have links to everything in the show notes. And I can't say enough about the absolute genuineness of you, Jayson, and just the ability to, I'll send you a crazy text and you'll answer it back without even batting an eyelash, you know, and there's a bunch of,
yeah, for sure,
you
man.
Know, so it's great. I love watching the shed hunting you've been doing. Just keep up.
Thank you, sir.
Great stuff you're doing to promote the hunting that we all love and want to do.
Jayson, I live it. I love it. And I am here to help anybody get into the industry, answer any questions, tips. You know, I'm just here to keep our heritage and our way of life alive.
Sweet. Well, again, I can't thank you enough for your time. Everybody, I'm going to
thank you.
You know, take off to check these guys out. And I look forward to seeing what you guys are up to. And we'll talk again soon. You have a great afternoon.
You too, Jayson. Thanks a lot for phoning. And I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, thanks, buddy.
Peace and love, brother.
Yeah, peace and love. No more signed autographs.
Bye.
Bye.
Come early spring, it's getting green, fish are on the bed, and hear those turkeys gobble. It's ringing in my head. The winterized bass boat, here comes another year. Yeah, we command the outdoors round here. Man, the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Come summertime, we're feeling fine, fishing on the lake, flipping jigs and Carolina rigs, from early morning till real late. Bonfires on the creek bank, kick back a couple beers. Yeah, we command the outdoors around here. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Next year's dozen till you know winter's on the way. Brushing blinds and deer stands. The fever starts to creep. Fill our freezers full of ducks, lots of tender deer. Yeah, we command the outdoors around here. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. So grab your guns and shells, boys. Put on your camouflage. 'Cause we command the outdoors around here. We command the outdoors.